Get him all situated right there. Good morning, beautiful friends. I just took a shower, wrapped my little leg up like a sandwich in saran wrap, and I no longer smell like last week and surgery. So movement in the right direction. I'm really excited for today's video and slightly nervous. I do not usually do any kind of trendy video topics or video tags or anything like that, but I saw these videos going around, like the assumption videos of what you assume about me. And to be honest with you, it really interests me. I am fascinated with assumptions about people and really wanted to know what you guys assumed about me and wanted to respond to that. So that's what we are going to do today. I asked you guys on Instagram and on the YouTube community tab what you assume about me in any category, and I am going to go through those and respond to those right now. Are you guys ready? Am I ready? I'm not sure. I'm actually kind of nervous about this. I think it'll be really cool. I'm difficult to offend, so I asked you guys to be really honest, but it is also kind of weird to hear a lot of people's assumptions about you. Let's do this. Ippy-san assumes that I know how to handle stressful situations. Yes, that is actually 100% accurate. I think that I've been in enough stressful situations and gone through enough extended trauma that I've learned to exist in crisis really well. The flip side of that is that I have actually spent months in therapy specifically learning how to live normal life because I spent so long living with life, like everything exploding around me, essentially. It's hard to like learn to just relax and for life to be normal. So yes, I think I'm a good person to have around when crisis hits because I get calm and clear-headed and can handle it. But the normal life thing, I am still working on. RK Jackson assumes that I am an introvert. Yes, I am definitely an introvert. But if you met me in real life, a lot of people assume that I'm an extrovert because I'm really personable. Like I really like people. I love interacting with people, but it's also exhausting for me. So I'll go out, I'll do stuff, I'll hang out with people, go to an event, but then I will need a massive gulps of alone time to recharge. If I don't have that, I start unraveling. I honestly think that's one of the reasons why I like YouTube so much, because I get to interact with people, I get to talk, which I love doing, but it's not face to face with everybody at the same time. In a way, it almost feels like meditation or journaling or like having a one-on-one conversation with somebody. Katie Fernandez says she assumes that I have the personality that makes everybody in the room feel comfortable. For starters, thank you, Katie. Yes, I do think that that is accurate. The reason I say that is people have told me that before in real life. In high school, I was voted most trustworthy person, like in my yearbook. And before everyone's like, hey, you were homeschooled, I was homeschooled, but I went to like a charter school that sent me to college for my junior year of high school. Confusing. But anyway, in that year, I was voted most trustworthy because people tend to feel comfortable around me. Giovanna Kelly says she assumes that I am done with my other channel because it didn't do as well as this one. So if you guys don't know, I actually have a second channel, and I've had that channel since October of 2017. It's called Trauma Talk, and on that channel, I talk about life in the aftermath of domestic violence, sexual assault, living with PTSD, depression, anxiety, mental health, but pretty heavy mental health topics. It never took off, as in I don't have as many subscribers, but that was never the point of it. The reason I started that channel was to help me process things and to share that with other people in hopes that it would help them as well. When I had my amputation, I took a short break from it thinking, okay, maybe I'll need a month to like physically recover, then I'll be good to go. But what I discovered is that I needed a lot more time mentally, and I still do. Talking about what I've gone through in that arena of things takes a lot of emotional energy. And now that I'm recovering from all of this stuff, that takes a lot of emotional energy. That passion has not waned at all, but it's too much to handle right now. I can't take on both things, if that makes sense. So that channel is not dead. I will definitely continue doing that in the future, but right now is not the time for that because it's a little too much. Riley Mierdos and a lot of people wrote this. Assumes that I was bullied as a kid. Like 12 different people wrote that in. I thought that was really interesting. The answer is no, actually. I was lucky that I was never bullied, but I was also very much an outcast. I was like the weird kid. I was homeschooled for starters, so there's that. But also, when I did interact with other kids, I wore like all boys' clothes. I didn't have any like gender dysphoria or anything like that. I just didn't like that I was a girl. I didn't feel comfortable in my own skin. I didn't want to hang out with girls. I only hung out with like all the skater kids and the other outcasts. And I was obsessed with Lord of the Rings and Pirates of the Caribbean and really into like fantasy and stuff like that. I was just an odd kid and kind of did my own thing and had a few friends, but my circle was pretty small and I had a really unique childhood. Not a bad childhood, just a unique one. But people didn't really pick on me, but people also didn't really super pay attention to me, if that makes sense. Oh, Ryan. Ryan Palmer. His assumption is that I didn't want to eat my leg. Ryan, your assumption is correct. If you don't know what I'm referring to, I'll link it down below. MJ Lynch says she assumes that I never expected YouTube to get this big. That's entirely accurate. I was literally just doing this to like help me process things, and then in the hopes that maybe anyone would ever watch anything going through something similar would help them process it too. Definitely did not expect this to happen. I'm very grateful that it did and very much enjoying it, but this is very unexpected to say the least. Then we have two contradicting assumptions, one that I'm very well off because I went to Ireland and one that I am very poor. Neither one is accurate. We saved up for a year and a half to go to Ireland, so we aren't like super rich in that we can just throw money around and go wherever we want, but we aren't super poor. We're very in the middle. Pay our bills, and I'm incredibly grateful for that, but I also need to get back to work because we rely on both incomes. So, just in the middle. Okay, so Kamea Johnson says, she assumes I am truly a genuine person and would low-key kill a comedy open mic. First of all, thank you. I truly appreciate the genuine comment, but you just hit on my biggest fear. Comedy. Stand-up comedy is literally the scariest thing that I can think to do. And I realize that that sounds dumb because I love public speaking, because I really enjoy talking to a camera, because I aspire to be a professional public speaker. But specifically stand-up comedy makes me want to pee my pants, makes me want to just like pass out and end up somewhere far, far, far away from a stage. It is like my worst nightmare. I do not think I'm funny. I think I would fall so flat. So I really appreciate that you think that I would low-key kill a comedy open mic, and maybe one day I should try it just to face that fear. Megan Zuer assumes that my husband and I have a very good relationship, and that is honestly true. And I say that with a lot of pride because it has not been easy to get there. We dated for 3 years before we got married. Then we got married, and we've been married for almost 4 years now. We're coming up on our fourth anniversary. And when we dated, it wasn't like sunshine and roses and rainbows. We had a lot of stuff to work through. Like, we both had our fair share of baggage and difficulties, and we worked really hard to like work through communication issues, to like work on our respective crap, to have a good relationship. By the time we got married, we had done a lot of hard work to have a really good relationship where we could actually talk about things, where when we fought, it didn't get ugly, where, you know, where we could actually enjoy our relationship. And he's honestly my best friend, and I'm so in love with him, and that isn't changing. Like, it's only grown in the 7 years we've been together. And so yes, Megan, you are 100% accurate. We have a very happy relationship, and I would say a very healthy relationship, because we have worked really hard on it, and I'm super proud of that. There are a lot of assumptions that I regret my amputations, and a lot of assumptions that I don't regret it. And the answer is that you guys probably know if you watch my videos that I don't regret it. There are definitely a lot of really hard moments and a lot of moments where I'm like, man, this would be so much easier if I had just not done this. But easier does not mean better. This was the best choice, and I'm very glad to have made it. And especially after surgery, I feel like I said a couple videos ago, I feel so much better. I feel really, really happy, really hopeful. So this is one of my favorites. Karina assumes that I am not a natural blonde because I make too much sense in my videos. Thank you. And that I don't cook because my kitchen is too clean. That is an amazing observation. You are entirely accurate about the cooking thing. I don't cook. I have tried from time to time to cook, and you would think because I was homeschooled that I would be like queen of cooking, but that is the one skill I did not ever allow my mom to really impart to me. I can sew, I can raise chickens, I can live in the forest, but I cannot cook. And actually, I am a natural blonde. So these roots you see coming through, that is my real hair color. Zane assumes I am secretly an alien from a far off planet trying to figure out this weird human world. How did they find me out? Gwen Clark assumes I am not actually productive, like, at all. You know, that's probably kind of accurate. Mostly what I do is make it through days right now, and I'm okay with that. Leah assumes that I smoke weed or smoked it a lot at one point in my life. Weirdly, no. I mean, yes, I have tried it. I live in Colorado where it's been legal for a while, but it does not agree with me. Like, it really does not agree with me. I've tried it a number of times, and it makes me paranoid and incredibly aware of all of the pain in my body. I know it's supposed to do the opposite of that, and I have tried like different kinds because people are like, no, you're trying the wrong kind, but I have tried a variety of kinds and it always does the same thing. It makes me feel terrible, so it just doesn't work for me. I am gonna try CBD oil here coming up pretty soon and I'll do a video on that, but that's about the extent of my experience with weed. Also, one of my favorite assumptions, Drew says he assumes in a totally non-negative way that I am not as well-adjusted as I seem and that I hate the term well-adjusted. Those things are both accurate. I do hate the term well-adjusted. I don't know what that's supposed to mean, and I'm not sure if it's something any of us should actually strive to be. I mean, I guess by any traditional definition, I am well-adjusted, but I think people probably perceive me as a lot more put together than I actually am. Like, I don't have my stuff all figured out. I don't have it all put together and well-adjusted. I really don't know what that's supposed to mean. Sydney assumes that I did not want to lose my foot, but that I am getting along without it. That is entirely accurate. Yes, this was not ever something that I wanted to have happen. And I feel oddly guilty saying that, because if you look at a lot of like amputee forums and support groups and stuff like that, a lot of people will be like, this is the best thing that ever happened to me. I would never change it. And at least at this point in my journey, I can't say that. Like, I would prefer to have a perfectly healthy leg back, and I feel like in some ways that must be wrong to say, but it just is honestly where I'm at. I'm not like upset, or I mean, I guess probably in some ways I am. I'm not like actively fighting against this, but just in a perfect world, I would rather have kept it and have had a good solution for fixing it, but that just didn't exist. So we went with the next best option, which was removing it. And so yeah, I am definitely getting along without it. I'm excited for the future. I'm really, really excited that cool options exist for prosthetics and that I will probably be able to walk and even run with minimal or no pain sometime soon. Dalton assumes that while I came from a Christian background, I am more open and accepting of others' point of view than the major stereotypical types of conservative Christians. That is very accurate. I did come from an extremely conservative, stereotypical Christian, homeschooled, sheltered background. And I really like filled that role for a very long time. I even went to like a Christian college and all of that. And my entire life was just about like faith, spirituality, God, pursuing God, becoming the best Christian that I could be. And then a lot of stuff happened and that really changed. And my faith is difficult for me now. But with that being said, I am very open and accepting to whoever someone is. I realize that I don't have all the answers. And I realize this probably sounds incredibly cliche, but it's really not my place to judge people for anything as long as they aren't hurting someone else. Yeah, so unless someone is doing something that actually hurts someone else, I have no problem with people. I am a very accepting person. We try to understand other lifestyles, other perspectives. That's something that's really important to me, and I spend a lot of time like trying to absorb other points of view. For instance, I spent a lot of time in my last recovery watching channels on YouTube about people who are gender non-binary and transgender, because that's something that I have personally never struggled with. But I also heard a lot of negative stuff growing up about that I don't want in my head anymore, because I don't think that there is a darn thing wrong with that. Because that's something I've never personally felt or dealt with, I want to hear people's perspectives. Like, I want to understand, I want to be the best listener that I can be, if that makes sense. So yes, I do try to be very open and very accepting and educate myself on different perspectives and different people. And yeah, I don't fall into the stereotypical mold of a conservative Christian, because I'm not a conservative Christian. I have faith, but it's difficult for me to define. So Robin, I don't know if you've been listening in to my husband and I, my conversations, but she wrote, I assume that if money was no object, you would and your husband would end up owning a large amount of property and you would have all kinds of animals and would probably run a rescue for said animals. Yes, so much accuracy in that statement. We have talked about that more times than I can tell you. That is an ultimate goal of ours, well, of mine specifically. There is nothing I would love more than to buy a massive piece of property somewhere involving forests and rivers and open fields and have all of the animals, all different kinds of animals, and rescue as many, specifically dogs, but all different kinds of animals as I can, because nature and animals make me so happy, and that is my idea of a perfect life. So Robin, yes, spot on, best assumption ever. So people have made assumptions about my height from being anywhere from 4'5" up to like 5'8". I will say that I am the same height as, I need to Google if this is actually accurate.
I was about to say Tom Cruise, but that's not accurate. I'm 2 inches shorter than Tom Cruise. Figure that one out. G. Laurent says, I assume you push yourself really hard, sometimes to your own detriment. You don't like asking for help, and the don't like asking for help part is an assumption a lot of people have and would prefer to do everything yourself. All of those things are very accurate. I do push myself really hard, but it's a weird inner dialogue because I never feel like I'm doing enough, especially physically, like with recovery or anything like that. I always feel like I'm slacking, and that usually ends up with me doing too much. That was really an issue, especially as I was a teenager in like my early 20s recovering from things. I would push myself way too hard to the point where I would accidentally hurt myself. And I learned that about myself, learned how to do a better job with that, how to kind of put more restrictions for myself in place, how to talk to people about it. The asking for help thing, that is one that is a daily struggle. And I want to say that I've gotten better about it since having my leg chopped off, but I don't know that I have. It's been 5 months and It is painful to ask for and accept help depending on the day. This one's interesting. Meadow Salt says she assumes that although you are strong in spirit, mean comments or stares, as much as you'd like to convince yourself otherwise, still secretly get me down. Yes, I will thoroughly admit that that is accurate. It, again, depends on the day. Some days I'm totally fine. Some days it could not bother me less. Some days I think it's funny. I watch a lot of YouTube videos. I'm pretty involved in this community, and I know a lot of the time people will be like, you know, forget the haters. It doesn't matter. It doesn't, like, you say whatever you want. It's never affected me, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I don't know if they're on another planet or if they know something that I don't, but like, the things that people say do have an effect on me to some extent. They don't, like, ruin my day. But depending on what they are, especially if there's something that I'm like secretly insecure about, generally about like my decision with my leg, yeah, it'll hurt a little bit. Or if people are staring or being weird in public, some days I'm 100% okay, and then other days, man, it does get to me, and I do not like admitting that because I would like to be stronger than that. I would like to be above that or whatever, but I'm assuming that it's a process, and I'm assuming that I'll get there because it doesn't bother me as much as it used to. Canadia Williams assumed that I wore headbands a lot in middle school. I don't think I'll be able to find a picture. Maybe I will be, but I would like stack headbands on top of headbands, like rainbow rows of headbands. How did you know that? That's a bizarre thing to assume, but so spot on. L. Cheryl assumes that I really like Pinteresty stuff and cheesy inspirational things. Yeah, I do. It's true. Katia Swift says, I assume that I'm not going to say you're proud of the mental health challenges that you've had, but you're proud that you're able to talk about them. Yes, that is true. That's something that I've had to work pretty hard at because of the stuff that I've gone through, because of the trauma that I went through, because of like the church that I was raised in and how mental health was not something to be talked about. I've had to work hard to put things into words, to gain a voice, to be able to speak. And yeah, I'm not like proud of the challenges that I've had. Those have been hard, but I am proud that I'm now able to talk about them. So this one's interesting. Two people said something similar. Jesse wrote, I assume that you would still take opioids even if you weren't in pain. And then I think it's Skeets. Yes, and Skeets McGraw said, I assume that at one point you abused drugs or alcohol to try to escape the pain. Thankfully, no. I'm not gonna say that that has not been a real, real temptation. When I was 20, my life fell apart in a violent, horrible way. And at that time, I also had basically unlimited access to very heavy painkillers. I don't know how I didn't end up being addicted. Sincerely, I had at least a little bit of a community left. I had a family I could talk to, and I had a couple friends. I don't even know why, but I have never abused opioids. I wouldn't take them if I wasn't in pain. I don't like taking them, and I don't know if I can say I never abused alcohol. I've gotten drunk a couple times intentionally to like stop thinking about things when I was like 22, 23. So I guess that probably counts as abusing alcohol, but it was never a pattern. I did, however, start smoking heavily from like 0 to 60, from like never having had a cigarette to smoking like half a pack a day within a couple weeks. And then that continued for like a year and a half. And then I quit when I met Brian. So while I have not abused drugs, I definitely have other unhealthy coping tendencies that some I've worked through and some I'm still in the process of working through. Tiger844 says they assume that I'm a very happy person and try to see the best in everyone. Yes, and I think that is almost to my own detriment sometimes, especially like this, the seeing the best in people. That was something that I was like born with. I feel like it's a character trait, and no matter how many crappy things have happened, I have not been able to shake that. I tend to always see the best in people. Because life happens, and because a lot of crappy things have happened, I definitely have difficulty actually trusting people, but I still tend to see the best in them. Madeline says, you seem nice, but if someone is mean to you, then it takes a while for you to forgive them, or you never do. So actually, no, I do tend to forgive people pretty quickly, unless it's something astronomically horrendous and horrible. And that's something that I've actually had to work on a lot, is like the boundaries thing, and not letting everyone get away with anything all the time, if that makes sense. Seeing the good in people is a good thing, but letting them walk all over you and get away with everything is not. And that is something that I let people do for years and have spent a significant amount of time trying to work through and trying to find boundaries with that and realize that you can forgive people and still not let them walk over you. Bronte assumes that I'm open-minded as well as logical and have a thirst for intellectual topics. Yes, very, very much so. Enough so that I think I frustrate my darling husband at parties, because like, if we're hanging out with people, and by parties I mean like if we're hanging out with like two friends, he wants to just like talk about fun things, like who won the fights last weekend, and I'm like, let's talk about religion and politics. I like talking about like deep things, like meaty things I can get my teeth into, and so I spend a lot of my time watching videos about things like that or reading things like that. So yeah, like I said before, I am very open-minded, but I try to be really logical with things. Anna assumes that YouTube is my only job. No, it is not. That would be cool one day because I really enjoy this. However, money dictates otherwise. Last but not least, Tyler assumes I have a robust meditation practice. Ugh, if only. I don't. I don't meditate ever. I have meditation apps on my phone, if that counts, which it doesn't. So let me know in the comment section if any of the assumptions or my answers surprised you, or if they were exactly what you expected and I am just not, if I'm just completely predictable. So thank you again, guys. This was a fun video for me to do, and I really appreciate the audience participation. You guys rock. I really appreciate it. Now I am going to lay down because I feel my energy like crashing again. I love you guys, I'm thinking of you, and I will see you in the next video, whenever that is. Bye guys. Okay, I forgot one thing, guys. I was closing down Instagram and I forgot this one. I wanted to read it because it just made me happy. Max Devlin assumes that I could probably kick someone's arse with one foot just as well as with two. So thanks for that, Max. I don't actually know if that's accurate, but we're gonna find out, because as soon as I can get back to jiu-jitsu, I am going to do that. Gosh darn it. So thanks for assuming I'm still a badass. I'm probably not, but one can dream.
Have heard from the sky all about it. Down the river high tide.